Welcome to part 1A of my series of presentations about the alkylation of alcohols. This first video is about the mechanism and scope of the Williamson ether synthesis, that is, the alkylation of alkoxides by alkyl halides or sulfonates. Although most name reactions show a broad applicability and usually work well, the Williamson ether synthesis unfortunately does not. I'll give you therefore a large number of examples, but the presentation became too long for a single video and I've split it therefore into part 1A and 1B. In the other presentations of this playlist, we'll have a look at the use of other suitable alkylating reagents and at reductive alkylations of alcohols with aldehydes, ketones and carboxylic acids. And because this is a difficult reaction, at the end of this first video, I've also listed some alternative strategies for the preparation of alkyl ethers that are not alkylations of alcohols. So, what are ethers used for? One important ether is MTBE, which is used as solvent and as fuel additive to increase knock resistance. This ether is prepared by the acid-catalyzed addition of methanol to isobutene. Methanol is prepared from carbon oxides, and isobutene is a byproduct of the thermal cracking of hydrocarbons. Another important ether is the solvent THF, which can be prepared from butenediol or by the hydrogenation of maleic anhydride. Unlike MTBE, which is not suitable for Grignard and related reactions, THF coordinates well to polar organometallics and is therefore often used as a solvent for reactions involving such strongly basic intermediates. THF can, however, be cleaved by organolithium compounds. A further important group of ethers are the oligomers of ethylene glycol. These are prepared from ethylene oxide by treatment with ethers, alcohols or water and used as solvents or additives in numerous products. These oligomers are more resistant to oxidative degradation than normal alkyl ethers, such as THF. In the classical Williamson ether synthesis, alcohols are first deprotonated stoichiometrically, and the resulting alkoxides are then treated with an electrophilic alkylating reagent. With most electrophiles, the alkylation is a normal bimolecular nucleophilic substitution. Alcohols are weak acids only, and the corresponding alkoxides are therefore strongly basic. Alkoxides with alpha hydrogen atoms are also potent hydride donors, and thus reducing agents, and solid alkoxides may even ignite spontaneously at the air. It is therefore important to avoid oxygen and other potential oxidants in the reaction mixture. Because oxidation of alkoxides leads to the formation of aldehydes or ketones that quickly form colored oligomers, a darkening of the reaction mixture can sometimes be prevented by a sacrificial reducing agent, such as a small amount of sodium or sodium borohydride. Alcohols are not nucleophilic enough to react with most electrophiles, but with very powerful electrophiles, such as trialkyl oxonium salts, free carbocations or protonated alcohols or ethers, alcohols can sometimes be alkylated directly, without stoichiometric deprotonation. I'll show you some examples in other videos of this playlist. Because alkoxides can be stabilized by hydrogen bonding, the pKa of alcohols in DMSO is usually much larger than in protic solvents. Most alcohols are less acidic than water, and only phenols or perfluorinated alcohols are stronger acids. Alcohols with heteroatoms in beta position, such as ethylene glycol, glycerol, and carbohydrates, are also more acidic than simple alkanols because of the inductive effect of the heteroatom through sigma bonds. Carbohydrates and phenols can therefore be etherified in water, while less acidic alcohols usually require aprotic solvents. Stoichiometric deprotonation of most alcohols requires strong bases or reducing agents, such as alkali metals or their hydrides, sodium amide or tertiary alkoxides. Sometimes alcohols can be etherified in biphasic reaction mixtures in the presence of phase transfer catalysts and a solid alkali hydroxides or saturated aqueous solutions of alkali hydroxides. Lithium alkoxides are not as nucleophilic as sodium or potassium alkoxides and are difficult to alkylate and not usually used for the synthesis of ethers. Suitable electrophiles include alkyl chlorides, bromides, iodides, sulfonates and epoxides. With iodides, the formation of radicals by single electron transfer has been observed in some instances. In the case of reactive benzylic or allylic electrophiles, weaker leaving groups may also be used with success. The most common side reaction of the Williamson ether synthesis is the formation of alkenes by beta elimination. The high basicity and nucleophilicity of alkoxides, combined with their low solubility, can complicate the choice of solvent. If toluene cannot be used because of insufficient solubility, THF or oligoethylene glycol ethers may be a suitable alternative. The latter can act as crown ethers and enhance the nucleophilicity of alkoxides by chelating sodium or potassium cations more effectively than THF or dioxane. Acetonitrile may also be used if the alkoxide isn't too basic. Acetonitrile is a good solvent and its dielectric constant is almost as high as that of DMF. SN2 reactions therefore proceed faster in acetonitrile than in toluene or in ethers. Many examples have been reported of the use of DMF or DMSO as solvents for Williamson etherifications, but such reactions are potentially dangerous. Both DMF and DMSO can decompose violently when heated with strong bases or acids, and numerous accidents have occurred. Moreover, DMF can react with alkoxides and yield formic acid esters. One important side reaction of the alkylation of alkoxides is beta elimination. This side reaction becomes dominant when going from primary electrophiles to secondary and then to tertiary. Tertiary alkyl halides with beta hydrogen usually only undergo elimination when treated with alkoxides. The sterical demand of the alkoxide is also critical, and tertiary alkoxides are difficult to alkylate with electrophiles that can be converted into alkenes. On this slide, the relative nucleophilicities of various alkoxides toward butyl bromide are shown. Except for sodium tert-butoxide, all alkoxides react faster than sodium hydroxide. This low nucleophilicity of sodium tert-butoxide is caused by its steric bulkiness. Sodium and potassium tert-butoxide are therefore suitable reagents for dehydrohalogenations. The relative rate of nucleophilic displacement of various halides by sodium methoxide is similar to that of the reaction with other nucleophiles. There's a large increase in reactivity when going from chlorides to bromides, but only a small increase or even a decrease when comparing bromides with iodides. I chose alpha-chlorohalides as example because I couldn't find any other. Alpha-chloroelectrophiles are much less reactive than simple alkyl chlorides. As shown in the table, methyl bromide reacts about 200 times faster with sodium methoxide than bromochloromethane. And a dichloromethane is surprisingly unreactive toward nucleophiles if compared with methyl or ethyl chloride. This is counterintuitive because alpha-chloroethers, for instance, are much more reactive than alkyl chlorides because the overlap of the filled sp3 orbitals at oxygen with the empty antibonding sigma-star carbon-chlorine orbital weakens the carbon-chlorine bond. Chlorine is, however, a weaker pi donor than oxygen, and alpha-chloroethers tend to react via carbocationic intermediates and an SN1 mechanism. The stabilization of carbon-halogen bonds by other halogens attached to the same carbon atom has been rationalized as resonance stabilization through hyperconjugation or as the result of the stabilization of radical anions by halogens. This effect is particularly strong with fluorine and when identical halogens are involved, for instance, when comparing methyl chloride with dichloromethane, chloroform, and carbon tetrachloride. In the references given here, you can find a more detailed discussion of this topic. Alkyl sulfonates, sulfates, and epoxides can also be used as electrophiles for the alkylation of alkoxides. Sulfonates and sulfates seem to undergo elimination much less readily than alkyl halides and are therefore superior electrophiles for the preparation of ethers from alcohols. So, what can go wrong? As shown on the previous slide, due to their high basicity, most alkoxides can cause dehydrohalogenations, and most base-sensitive functional groups are not compatible with the Williamson ether synthesis. Then, under forcing conditions, some tertiary alkoxides can undergo fragmentation, as shown here. The type of products obtained in this example suggest a homolytic bond cleavage with intermediate formation of carbon-centered radicals. Some phenolates, in particular deprotonated naphthols, react with electrophiles more like ketone enolates than true phenolates. Here, for example, benzylation of sodium 2-naphthoxide yielded large amounts of products alkylated at carbon. The regioselectivity of such reactions can sometimes be controlled by the choice of solvent, protic solvents usually giving larger amounts of carbon alkylated products. Because of their high basicity, alkoxides can cause the transesterification of even sterically demanding esters, as shown here. In this instance, transesterification probably proceeded by alpha deprotonation of the ester, followed by elimination of tert-butoxide and formation of a ketene. Interestingly, this reaction was faster than substitution of iodide. Still more surprisingly, this unwanted transesterification could be suppressed by conducting the reaction in a biphasic mixture of toluene and aqueous sodium hydroxide. Alkoxides with alpha hydrogen are readily oxidized by air or by aldehydes or ketones, and such oxidations can cause the formation of unexpected byproducts. In this example, a seemingly simple benzylation only yielded a small amount of the expected ether and significant quantities of a carbon benzylated alcohol. Such alkylations at carbon can be triggered by catalytic amounts of aldehydes, as shown here. Oppenauer oxidation of the starting alkoxide yielded an aldehyde enolate that was benzylated twice at carbon and finally reduced again by the starting alkoxide. Such side reactions can be avoided by adding small amounts of reducing agents to the reaction mixture. In this instance, a slight excess of sodium may have led to a higher yield of the expected ether. Alkyl halides with electron withdrawing groups at the halogen-bearing carbon can act as electrophilic halogenating reagents or oxidants. In this example, only 17% of the expected ether resulted, and a large part of the electrophile was reduced to methyl phenyl acetate. All the other major byproducts were formed from the reduced and oxidized starting materials. Because some ethers can be difficult or impossible to prepare by alkylation of an alkoxide, I'll give you here some potential alternative ether synthesis. One important strategy is the reaction of acetals or alpha halo ethers with carbon nucleophiles. The starting acetals are readily synthesized from aldehydes or ketones, and their reactions with a broad selection of carbon nucleophiles has been thoroughly investigated. These nucleophiles include polar organometallic reagents, enolates, enol ethers in combination with acid catalysis, boranes, stannanes, and more. One instance where the alkylation of phenolates is not the best approach for preparing aryl ethers is the synthesis of aryloxypropylamines, such as atomoxetine or fluoxetine. These are serotonin reuptake inhibitors used as antidepressants. Enantioselective synthesis based on phenolate alkylation would require the enantioselective reduction of a ketone and two clean SN2 displacements. Unfortunately, the phenolate alkylation in this case does not proceed smoothly, and a strategy based on alkoxide arylation by aromatic nucleophilic substitution is usually superior. Then, a number of reductive and oxidative strategies for the preparation of ethers have been reported, which I discuss more thoroughly in the last video of this playlist. In the next presentation, you can find numerous examples of alkoxide alkylations with specific reaction conditions to get an idea of the requirements of these reactions and their scope.